All right, happy Friday. Hello, everyone. Rhett?
This Dustin Wolf, he's too short. He's not going to make it.
He can't do it. He's too short.
I think they should start a new league where everyone has to be under 6'2". You could maybe play in that league. Not going to work here. I've seen six games. It's clear to me he's too small.
Ryan, he's too short.
Yeah, that's no. You're right. It's not this small. It's the height.
Yeah, he's just too
short.
Too
much net.
It's not his. I mean, it's not his fault, but he's just it's too short.
Once you get to the NHL, there's the bigger right. Like it's a different size net than the leagues that he's been dominating in his whole life.
You gotta be comfortable in those bigger nets when you go to the NHL. And he's clearly.
I don't know.
Proof is in the pudding, right?
Anyway, I went to the game last night. Might not remember a bunch. Do you have any? Feel good for the kid. That's a nice performance, Rhett.
Okay, good for the kid, but what about, aren't you home alone? What do you mean you went to the game and drank so much you forget what happened?
No, I actually didn't drink. I was sort of playing into the bit of him being too short. We had a coaches get together from the team this year. The season is wrapping tomorrow with a family skate, parents versus kids. But the coaches, we'd been talking about getting together all year, and finally it was like, we're doing it. So we brought in the heavies. We got the serious babysitter, some Monopoly for the boys, and we hustled home after a victory for the Flames over the Vegas Golden Knights.
I went to bed after the second period, assuming, and this is the thing, you don't want to assume, Ryan, because
you could make an ass of you and me.
And sure is something, Flames come back and win.
And it's funny because you're like, man, you know what? This is actually a pretty good effort. But
yeah, they were playing hard.
You know, it's just sometimes you run into these better teams, you play well, and you don't get 2 points. But not unlike the Pittsburgh game, which you were back in town for Mika night, this group found a way to have a good third period, and they're rewarded with 2 points because of it. And that snaps an ugly skid, 3 losses in a row, a run of play that wasn't
subpar
good
play.
Defensively.
Yeah.
And where they looked severely outclassed and sloppy. A lot of those things were cleaned up last night.
They looked hungrier. They had a better effort. They looked engaged, and they kicked the shit out of Vegas in the third period.
Good work, boys. 4-1, your final. Welcome to Barnburner. If you haven't tapped in, you can go check out Afterburner last night with Cammy and Mike Gold making his Afterburner debut. Lots of commentary on last night's game. Let's get to ours. We do it for McLeod Law. Our good friends at McLeod Law include Peter Klein. He's the personal injury guy, but also, did you know he's the go-to guy in Calgary for your disability insurance claim? If your long-term disability insurance company is refusing to pay your insurance benefits, contact Peter. He'll get you the disability benefits that you paid for and deserve. Also, Shane King over at McLeod Law, Litigation and Dispute Resolution Group. You've been laid off, employment rights, things like that. He'll help break things down for you in, English, not legal mumbo jumbo. So the opening statements from last night, they're underway, and you couldn't help but feel good for the young netminder. The only mistake was not his. It was Braden Pahal centering to Anthony Mantha.
That's not true. Oh, there was the only mistake that ended up in the back of his net.
Yeah, fair. Yeah, this is fair. That's and let's remember where we were with Dustin Wolf. You and I were at his NHL debut, last game of the year, last April. It's like, oh my gosh, like meaningless game at San Jose. Finally get to see the kid. All right. Well, you know, they're going to move a defense or a goalie this summer. They'll make room for Wolf.
Got to have room for him.
Here we are a year later. They've not made room for Wolf, if not for 4 separate trips to the trainer's room from Jacob Markstrom. You wouldn't really have seen Wolf at all this year. I guess they had the Vladar injury when they were talking that trade with New Jersey ahead of the deadline. But the last game we saw was also against the Sharks from Wolf before last night. That was not a good one. There were soft goals. The team was shitty in front of him, but he probably also would tell you he was shitty and didn't get a chance after that to make amends. He was back down to the minors, and you thought, oh, there's a little bit of creep, sort of a little bit of doubt creeping into the fan base regarding his future. This is one of those starts that reminds you of the kid's pedigree. Just goalie of the year every year for the last 4 years, no matter where he's played.
Yeah, no expectations now. Like next year when he's starting in Calgary, goalie of the year probably is a good
No, you're going to say that, and we're going to come to camp, and there's going to be three goalies. It's like, well, you don't want to lose Bedard on waivers. And
he played good, and he made some big saves, and then they went down and scored too, which was
that's the one. This is the play, and I was there, and you're happy when Blake Coleman's there. Let's watch the play. I don't know. I mean, it's you either can't win or you can't lose, depending on your outlook at life. If you like to be positive, boy, this is a great situation for the Flames. You beat a good team. The kids are shining. You know, you've got some wind in the sails of Dustin Wolf after that one. Matt Coronato has a nice goal. Probably watch that one too, because we've been telling you that. And it's like, this pass isn't perfect. There's a man right near you, but somehow not only do you get it off with accuracy, with some velocity, and you beat, you know, the Stanley Cup winning goaltender from last year. Pretty good night for the kids. So there's your glass half full. The half empty is like, oh boy, you know, they really were getting close to pick number 10 and 9. And now you're that much further ahead of Montreal. And
come on.
I guess you got Buffalo coming in a week or so. But
well, Buffalo's back in the mix, they think. Here, they're wound up.
Byram again with like every night now. How many points is he getting? Is it 1, 2, or 3? What are we doing?
That, but I was going to bring it up today.
To me, Goose.
Well, if Bowen Byram was available.
Who knows? I don't know if he's available or not. No, well, the Flames weren't trading Casey Mittelstad to the Avs, right? It was going to be a rental.
They have another centerman that might be.
In Buffalo or in Calgary?
What do you say?
I know there was Backlund chatter in the summer before he signed his extension with Colorado. Lindholm, sure. I don't know. I mean, would the Avalanche move Byram for a rental? That's the question. And I don't know the answer to that. I mean, Connie would know. I don't know who else would know. Could you give him a little truth serum?
I don't know, but he would look pretty good. He's anyway.
High-end skill set. And good for Bowen Byram. Like, kind of buried there for a bit. Injury issues have been super common since his draft. And they must love him in Buffalo. They're coming in. Not a lot of hockey here for the Calgary Flames. They play Montreal Saturday, Ovi and the Caps Monday, and then they're off till next weekend. So you got Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, all days without games. I'm sure there'll be some off days mixed in, and we'll get really creative on this show, I'm sure.
Yes.
Pike's book actually drops on Tuesday. Big shout out to Ryan Pike.
Wait, Pike has a book?
I told you, he's an author. He's got multiple books on the go, but one actually is released. Pre-sales available now, I believe, on Amazon. Tuesday it drops. So we will have Pike in studio Tuesday, which is a good day because, again, no hockey all week. Monday, that's it. And then Saturday, we're at Greta for the big thing. So, and then also, you might have a tab on a former NHL or a very good one, a cup winner, coming in next Thursday, potentially. Have we got word on that? I don't want to jinx anything.
You're jinxed it for sure.
Okay, well, I haven't said his name, so I'm not jinxing it.
Away on vacation.
So we'll figure
early April. We're looking for April now.
So we spent a lot of this week talking about, boy, what if the veterans don't try? Last night didn't look anything like that. Let's get back to that convo. Where is the state of the room right now? You could have been 12 out after last night. Instead, I believe you're 8 back now. Proverbial 4-pointer.
Sorry, say that again. I got distracted by Pike up Pike's book.
Yeah, well, we'll drop some links later. Hey, Jack, maybe go find us a Pike book link for everyone because people are going to be excited about that. All Flames, all Pike. Pike bombs every page. That's a guarantee. We talked about where the veterans' heads at. Whether they believe or not, we can only guess. When does looking at the calendar and summer vacation and how do you keep... You don't worry about the kids. They're jacked up. They're excited to be there. You don't worry about Coronato and...
No,
Pospisil and Wolf being jacked up, but you do worry about guys on 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years left on their deal and saying, looking around, going, are we not going to be competitive here? None of that was there last night. And we wondered about it on the weekend, although those are just really good teams on a tough road trip. Where are we at with the vets now?
Well, and it was fresh. The changes were fresh and kind of the...
Mm-hmm. Reality hit quick, didn't it?
Yes.
Boom, second paragraph. Even though
they knew it was coming, it was like, ooh, this is... And they were really good teams, and it was no good. And maybe they were at the beach, and they had too much fun, too. I don't know. I
hope so.
But that was not a good road trip as far as the last two games. And then the game when they – but I thought last night they all looked engaged. They looked good. The lines got switched up, and I liked it. Like, there was no complaining for me. Not that
and so was. If you'd said the Flames are going to beat the Vegas Golden Knights without Jacob Markstrom, without Kuzmenko again – your boy Kuzmenkov's found a way to miss a lot of games since he's arrived here.
Yeah.
It was nicked up, and then it was illness, and now it's nicked up again. Then also, you got Zeri's not even in there. I think that's probably a pretty good omen for the future. I know I keep talking about next year and your first-round pick if you're bottom 10, but, like, the kids look good, man. The kids look good.
Kids are engaged. They're playing hard. Like I said, Huska made some changes to the lineup or the line, so maybe that. Mm-hmm. Got a few guys going, but I don't know where. I mean, you can watch the defense and go, some loose ends there.
Yeah.
But what we've preached about all year is results are almost secondary. How are you approaching and how are you competing?
It's totally true. Because last year, this time, the roster was much better and the process was shit.
You're terrible. And
this year, the roster's not as good necessarily, but the process is so much better. That's something that I think could buoy spirits and morale, whether that's in the room and the organization and the fan base. Like, you can't go compare your number one center, your number one D and match up to contenders and say, we're good tonight. It's just not that group. But if you know you're going to get four lines working their tails off, and we get some really green defensemen, but you know what? They're working their tails off. They're trying to play within the structure of what they've been given. There is a chance, right?
Yeah, they're not putting their feet up like I did yesterday. So those guys are going to be engaged, and they're going to be trying, and they're going to be mistakes made, but they'll battle. And that's, I think we're fine with that. The efforts, again, most of this season have been pretty damn good. And I thought last night was another example of that. And like they turned the table on Vegas and owned them in the third period. And I thought the first two were fine too. It was, but I really thought they took it to Vegas in the third.
And also, let's not just say, oh, you know, it's Vegas looking past the Flames. I mean, they win, they move into third in the Pacific last night. Instead, they stay in wild card two. Like, Vegas got a lot to play for. And we'd said it before we got on air. Like, there's a lot of new pieces and a lot of guys that aren't healthy there. We've seen them do this before. So we just assume they're going to snap their fingers and look like a juggernaut. But there's some things they got to get right before that happens, mostly on the health front.
Well, and I almost wonder, like, they came back and beat Seattle in the last game, correct?
Yes.
Late goal and then a win in overtime.
Yeah.
I mean, that should have been, I'm not saying I didn't watch the game, but if they're thinking they need to win and they, my point being, they almost fluked it out.
Yeah.
Like, that's a hell of a pass to score that over that last
Stevenson.
Yeah, the Stevenson pass. But they were in a situation where they could have lost that game, and then they lost to the Flames last night. They're kind of stumbling their way through this. They need to get it together. They've got a bit of a cushion, I think, but it's not that much where they can just float.
Yeah, and I think if Flames fans remember, this Vegas team, their results in the playoffs directly impact the Flames. There's a third-round pick that turns to a second if they win a round. If you're wild card one or two, you've got a tough matchup. You know, maybe you're going to Colorado. Maybe you're going to Dallas. Maybe you got to face Vancouver. Not that necessarily it's easy if you get up to the three spot, but I don't know. I feel like that Vegas Edmonton series they played last year, that'd be fun. I think the path probably easier in the three hole than the wild card, but we'll see. And I'm with you. The Seattle one, you're like, man, are they going to lose to this? And then they rally late and you're like, okay, that feels like they've turned the corner now.
Yes.
And then you see last night, you're like, oh, okay.
Maybe they're beatable.
Not yet. Those are our opening statements for McLeod Law. A reminder, you can find them at McLeod-Law.com or on social media at McLeod Law LLP. And again, not just Peter Klein, Shane King, but a great staff of lawyers. Whatever your challenge is, business or personal, they are in it with you. Professionals with a common goal, helping clients meet their goals. Win for the Flames. Montreal tomorrow, 5:00 start. People are excited. I don't know that the standings matter. Maybe they could have a car show fans. Instead of the game. The
standings don't matter to Habs fans. You're from Western Canada and the Montreal comes to town. You're pumped up.
This is an annual pilgrimage. This is not a hockey game.
Olé, 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 olé.
Right? And all of you saw, it's a 5 o'clock start. So there's some people that'll
get a nice
early start on a Saturday. Should be lit.
It's always fun, like having Montreal come to town because you know the fans are going to make some noise and they're going to be into it. And it's a great atmosphere in the building every time.
Totally. Yep. Excited. That'll be good. Want to tell you, $1 million. Not many people have the chance to make $1 million. Rhett,
give it to me.
Now, have you seen the ad on TV? It's like, this is for everyone. I'm sub Tom Brady. Tom, you've won too much. This is like, I feel like Service Credit Union needs to add in the anyone could win $1 million except Rhett Warner, because he's already stolen enough from the Calgary Flames. But yeah, I mean, Jack could win. I could win. You could win. Anyone can win. It's the Service Big Share back for the sixth year. $1 million just by saving money. Huh? Let me explain. Anyone can enter. All you got to do is become a member and start saving with Service. Every $500 that you slide over into a Service account will give you 5 entries into the Service Big Share contest. Transfer your existing savings to Service for a chance to win $1 million. Contest ends at the end of April, so that means get her gone here. Running out of runway. Skill test required for rules. Visit service.ca/win. I'm actually reading the fine print. You are eligible to win this. So,
I'm going to take that back.
And so once you move back to Calgary this summer.
Well, you know.
Hurry. You got to get in before the end of April.
There was a rich bastard at my kids hockey game this morning by an old roommate of mine by the name of Brian Campbell. And I mentioned to him that you realize you still haven't paid me.
He still owes you rent from Buffalo.
3 years of room and board.
Jeez. So that would have been what years? Like 99 to 02, no, something like that?
Been there in 90, probably.
You came to Calgary 02, 03, or 03, somewhere 03.
2001, 2002, 2003-ish.
1, 2, and 3. Man, the juice is going to kill him here. And the room and rent wasn't bad. The board, it's cheap in Buffalo. It's just that interest that's been accruing.
Oh, so good.
The last
20
years.
I got to call one of those loan shark guys and break some ankles here, knee caps, whatever they do.
So once you get that Brian Campbell rent money, slide it into Service, and then
there's
your million you're missing.
Yeah, I got to turn that into another million. It's going to be sweet.
So what is he doing? Because he, I believe, finished up in Chicago, and wasn't that where he was living?
Still working for the organization in Chicago.
So what's he doing in Buffalo? Why are you seeing him?
Big Ryan Miller fashion show charity thing.
Ryan Miller fashion show?
Mm-hmm. They did. When Ryan Miller was here. It's weird because if I really dig into it, it's a convoluted story. I got traded for Wilson and a fifth.
Okay.
The fifth was
Ryan Miller.
Ryan Miller. I got involved in a charity called Carly's Club. Well, the young girl that had cancer. I've told people about it before, blah, blah, blah. It turned into quite a big charity locally and nationally, actually. It's now called the Courage of Carly's Club. But when I got traded out of Buffalo, JP Dumont, who's my good buddy, who is also in town, he kind of grabbed the reins of that charity and carried it on. And then when he left, Ryan Miller took it on. So the guy, the father of Carly, or the adopted father of Carly, Carly's uncle, because Carly's parents both died of cancer, I'm good friends with. He's still involved in the charity, blah, 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 blah. Ryan Miller's charity catwalk is for the Courage of Carly's Club, which I've started. And so it's all a convoluted story, a lot of interwoven lives.
So not only did you bring Mika Kiprusoff to Calgary, you also brought Ryan Miller to Buffalo.
Ryan Miller to Buffalo?
Have they not named streets after you yet? What the hell's going on
here? I don't know
what's
wrong with the hockey world. I get no response. Rodney Dangerfield, you could say, right? Like,
hey, Jack, do you know the Rodney Dangerfield reference?
No, who is Rodney?
You just can't get any respect. God.
Can you punch it? Did you just say who's Rodney Dangerfield?
You got to remember how young Jack is. I mean,
oh, I know.
There's going to be people watching saying, yeah, I don't either. You remember the movie Caddyshack?
No. What is Caddyshack?
I want to have hope for these young people. I really do. But it's just if kids aren't raised right, it's how are they supposed to go out in the world and accomplish anything?
It's not a 15-second TikTok video, I'll tell you that. So probably he won't watch it.
I think he'd like it. It's young Bill Murray. It's Rodney Dangerfield. It's a movie set at a golf course. It is a comedy. And there's a chocolate bar in the pool joke that is timeless. Clears the pool out. Beautiful stuff. Anyway. No. Jack's already tuned out. That was longer than 15 seconds.
Back to the Steelers.
How are we doing over there, Steelers boy?
I'm doing good. There's actually some big news. Aaron Donald just retired.
No way. From the Rams.
Yes.
One of the most disruptive D linemen of all time. Double teams his whole life, practically. What a stud. I got screwed that year they won the Super Bowl. He should have won MVP. He was awesome. And made the play.
Why does that screw you?
Because it was like 30 to 1. I had some dough.
Oh, you had some juice on it. Okay.
Yeah. Anyway. You know. I mean, there's that. You get screwed on some things like that. But then other times you're like, you know what? Our life is good, Rhett.
Yeah, you can also get screwed over on Stanley Cups. And...
Well, you did that, yeah. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you get to walk the catwalk with Brian Miller, so that evens out. What are you wearing, by the way?
I am not.
Heard it was this slinky sort of one strapper.
Yeah, I've got a I don't. It's a red. It's black and red is the theme. So I don't know. I got a game, and I'm going to go down there. I'm going to have a few pints with my boys, enjoy it. But I'm not going to get overly dressed up. I'm not.
You're not
on the catwalk. Okay. They're announcing all the alumni. I am not part of the fashionistas that are actually showing off the goods.
That's kind of cool. Like not kind of cool. That's really awesome that a charity you helped get off the ground is just, it's grown and blossomed to this huge national thing. And now many players later, it's still kicking ass in Buffalo.
Going, and they're going to walk out on that stage and wiggle it.
Who's they, by the way? Like, is it the Sabres? Are there models?
No, it's all, it's a lot of, I'm sure there are other models and stuff like that, but there's a lot of alumni.
Does Rob Ray get to go feature some modern sweatpants on the runway?
Rob Ray is beyond grumpy today.
Oh, really?
He's happy. His kid scored this morning. We had a big win, so that's good. But the Sabres are now on a 12-day road trip, and he's like, oh, this is too much.
So is he traveling for all the games, or how does his kid work?
Oh, yeah. He's on the road again.
Yeah. So he would have on the road again. He was at the game this morning and now he's gone for essentially 2 weeks plus.
That's right.
What's going on for 12 games? Did you say, or 12 days?
12 days.
Okay. So there's no event at the arena. It's just a big
I would trip. Guess there's something going on at the rink, but it's not it's not the Ringling Brothers circus.
Yeah, it was the circus road trip the Hawks used to do every year, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. You know what? I got screwed on that Aaron Donald bet, but I did get to go to Jasper and hang out, play pond hockey, win a title. You know, we got our own beer.
Beautiful.
Life's good, Rhett. And we want to remind you, you want to live the good life. Spring's coming in Jasper, Rhett. You got to get booking. I mean, there's lots of snow up there. The ski hill's still rocking, but don't forget to plan your spring adventure when you're up there because you want the pristine wilderness. You know, it's kind of like the other place in the mountains, but just like none of the crowds. Beautiful stuff. Reminder, Spring Cabins, the properties opening up here, April 1, Pine Bungalows, the Alpine Village, May 2nd, Patricia Lake Bungalows, May 3rd, Takara Lodge, May 16th, Sunwapta Falls Mountain Resort, May 16th. You guys are booking this stuff, right? Get planned, get going, and, celebrate being out in the great outdoors.
Celebrate good times.
So for more on these events and more, go to jasper.travel. And a reminder, yes, the spring stuff's opening, but also spring skiing gets going. And how about this? Family ski deal, two adults, two children, and a family pass for less than $300. That's not bad at all. jasper.travel. I believe we have an NHL insider ready to rock and roll, which means we are heading to our TELUS Insider Hotline, brought to you by our good friends at TELUS. They, of course, have been partners with the Calgary Flames for many, many moons, including the TELUS Club, which is the premium club at the Saddle Dome. Also, the TELUS Skater Program with the Flames, where they identify deserving youth to participate in the pregame skate and experience what it's like to feel like an NHL player on the dome ice with the crowd. TELUS, making things friendlier. Visit tellus.com/givesback to find out more about the most giving company in the world. Darren Dreggers, our NHL insider on a Friday. Dregs, we got boomers reporting from Ringette Provincials. Must be a problem with this hookup because we haven't seen him all day.
That's not what he sent me via text. He essentially said it's post-trade deadline, so he's just shortening his work weeks. So he's going on long weekend mode now till the end of the year.
That is not the story we got. Jeez.
Yeah. No, I didn't get anything at all.
That's why you're the insider, Dregs.
This is true. Who could quibble with this? Is your reporting? I can't. Seriously, we were going to question you on that?
He literally said, I'm off today, but Pinder and Rhett are doing the show. Are you good? I said, yes, I'm around. And he goes, deadline's over. You're just hanging around the house in your Hugh Hefner robe 24/7, question mark. That's what I got from him today.
Well, you got to answer that question for us. You got changed for us. You didn't have to do that.
No, I appreciate that. You know what? Believe it or not, I'm not complaining. It's just for the reality. You can probably hear the gravel. I've been sick since last weekend. Just sucked. Mm. But coming out of it and heading to Florida for the general manager's meetings.
Boca, where are we going?
Yeah. What's that?
Boca Raton, where are we hosting this year?
What is it? It's Palm Beach. So Manalapan is actually, I think, where the meetings take place. You know, back in the good days, before our industry started shrinking and all of that, we used to stay in the NHL Beach Resort Hotel. I mean, it's fabulous, right? You're right on the water. Don't do that anymore. I'm not complaining. It's still nice to be in Florida. But, you know, with all due respect, there is a difference between, say, the Boca Beach Resort and the Fairfield Inn, which is where I will be checking into on Sunday.
Poor Fairfield
Inn. Vibes. For sure.
not complaining. Let's be clear here.
To be clear, that complaint? Yeah. Not a complaint. Okay.
No,
very good.
No.
So walk us back. Last Friday was the deadline. We had you on a day before because of how hectic the deadline is. And we played a clip earlier this week because NFL free agency just opened, which is a similar kind of frenzy. Yeah. Adam Schefter someone told him that you can see how much screen time you've been, you know, staring at over certain amounts of days. And he had on two phones, a total of 17 hours of screen time in that opening day after free agency, which doesn't leave a lot of time for, you know, eating, sleeping, not staring at a screen. How nutso are those days for you leading into last Friday's deadline? And do you feel like you do need to just go into a coma for a few days after because the hours are so nuts?
Yeah, they are. And it's, you know, we're not doing a ton of heavy lifting. We're not saving lives here. We're working our phones. Mm-hmm. And it can be, this sounds like an exaggeration, but it can be 24/7 because there are oftentimes where I'll get a text message or a call, you know, past midnight Eastern. And sometimes it's breaking news. Sometimes it's just, hey, you know, do you have any idea what this team is doing? Because it's another team that has interest in the player that is potentially in the process. I have no idea. I use my phone as a tool. I don't like screen time and all that, unless it pops up on my phone, which I think happens once a week, right? Where you'll get just a little band that goes across that says, this week you spent umpteen hours or whatever. That's the only way that I know. And obviously, the weeks, the days leading up to the trade deadline, you know, it's a lot more involved than that. But, you know, we've gotten, you know, so used to it, I think, over the years that I wouldn't say we do less, but it feels like we do less because there are so many people involved in that process now, including the teams. You know, before social media, you know, it was like shooting fish in a barrel. I mean, if you had a contact that was involved in management or you were, you know, had a good relationship with the agent of the players involved, that's how you'd break information. That's how you'd break trades. Now with social media, the teams break their own trades a lot of the times, right? So it's gotten less and less emotionally taxing than maybe what it was, you know, 10, 15 years ago.
Okay, so you've done how many deadlines now? Have we kept track? Like, you got to be talking 3 decades of this, haven't you?
Yeah, pushing. Like, I started in Toronto in 1998. I don't think we did 99. We either started in 2000 or 2001. And believe it or not, you know, you guys will probably both remember this name because it's just an interesting name. Sven Butenschon.
So played against Sven and Junior.
6'10" Sven. Anyway, I think he got traded to the Pittsburgh Penguins, if memory serves mm-hmm. me, in mm-hmm. one of those early years. And okay. it happened at like 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning. And I was working at SportsCenter at the time. And I don't even think TSN had a studio component to it. It was just Bob McKenzie and Gord Miller and yeah. the group that they had at TSN, just, you know, putting this stuff out on TSN.ca more than ever. We happened to be in studio for something. Maybe we were going to come in and do a recap of the day or whatever.
Sure.
And Butenschon gets traded, and we've got a show happening at the time. And either myself or Nick Kiprios or both of us went up on set and talked about this trade. And I think the brass and the bosses of Studio TV went, ooh, wait a minute. Maybe we should do something with this.
He went from Pittsburgh to Edmonton.
There.
Is that what it was? Okay. Wow, Rhett.
What year was that, Rhett?
2001, I think it is.
Yes. There
it
is. So there you go. Nailed and I think
2001.
There you go. So from that point forward, I kid you not, I think all of the network bosses went, okay, wait a second. We have the capability to do live TV for an extended window. Is there an appetite for this? And yeah, I mean, ever since then, you know, aside from a couple of lockouts and work stoppages and whatnot,
right.
Yeah. I've done every one since. Yeah.
So how did this year, 2024, stack up to the others? And what will you remember about it now that you're a week out?
This one was better than most, to be fair. And, you know, I think you're looking at some of the trades. I mean, Bobby Mack breaks the Tomas Hertl trade to the Vegas Golden Knights. Nobody had that one on their bingo card. We weren't speculating, talking about, and trust me, I went after Mike Greer a dozen times in the last month. They're just, yeah. hey, you know, not necessarily about Hertl, but, you know, what are you doing? What are some of the pieces that, you know, we should be looking at? You know, is there anything front burner? Are you just kind of trying to encourage some sort of casual back and forth? And then as Kelly McCrimmon acknowledged to the media locally after the fact, he'd been working on that trade since what, January? What's that?
Yeah, and so for here in Calgary, that all makes sense now that the conditions put on that first rounder in the Hanifin deal, because McCrimmon's been working on this Hertl deal, and that was the pick that for whatever reason San Jose and Vegas wanted in the deal.
And we talked about how rare it is for a general manager to leave a first round pick unprotected, like they did with that 2026 pick, because who knows? I mean, maybe they do finally take a step back and Calgary's in a great spot. So, you know, when you got a deal like that, that makes a splash, that's significant. I learned early in the morning, basically, you know, probably around 8:15 Eastern AM when we signed on, that Winnipeg, you know, we had reported that Winnipeg was kicking tires on a forward, looking for, you know, if they could grab a top six guy, that'd be great, certainly a top nine. And I got wind early in the morning that they were at least going to make an offer on Toffoli. And, you know, that one, again, kind of fed us until it actually happened, because, you know, clearly what had transpired was what went down the night before when Jake Gensel ended up going to the Carolina Hurricanes, and Tom Fitzgerald and the New Jersey Devils are waiting for that deal to happen so that now they've got an open market for Tyler Toffoli. And when the dust settled, I don't think that there would have been a player more shocked than Tyler Toffoli was that he was going to Winnipeg.
Really? Okay.
Oh, yeah. He did not see that coming. And, you know, I'm sure, you know, he looks at the team and can see that, you know, the Winnipeg Jets appear to be, they've stumbled a little bit since the deadline, but they look like they're a good team, a team that should go deep. So I think when he came to terms with it, he was like, all right, you know, I can see how I'm going to fit there. I mean, they've got multiple good pieces. They've got a Vezina winning goaltender. Like, why wouldn't I want to go there?
Yeah.
But I don't think Kevin Cheveleyoff believed he was going to get Tyler Toffoli. In fact, I know, again, when the morning started, he was struggling trying to make a deeper connection with Fitzgerald. You know, he wasn't getting a whole lot of love and a whole lot of feedback on what that trade might look like if he was to present an offer. And then maybe 2 hours later, they had basically closed the deal. So not that Winnipeg didn't give up enough, but it kind of tells you what the market did on Tyler Toffoli. And I think Tom Fitzgerald and the Devils were counting on it going the other way.
Yeah, that's fair. And you could even argue the return for Gensel. I mean, geez, you move a first to see Adam Henrik and Carrick go to Edmonton. Yeah. And then I guess it depends what you view a Bunting as. But boy, right. that's a very, very good forward. And there was not a first in that package, although there was a lot of young players going from Carolina to Pittsburgh.
Yeah, and so I always struggle when I'm asked to analyze a deal like that in the moment because, hey, admittedly, I don't pay close attention to what the prospects are doing. Bob McKenzie and Craig Button, these guys are the draft gurus, and maybe they follow. Craig certainly does, the evolution of the player. So automatically, I start kicking around the league and trying to get the perspective of other top pro scouts or management types. And in fairness to Kyle Dubas, the response was positive. They feel like the prospects that the Pittsburgh Penguins acquired are going to be decent NHL players. Whether or not they're going to ever evolve to what Jake Gensel was in Pittsburgh and what, they hope that he'll be for the Carolina Hurricanes, we're going to have to wait and see. But, man, it just seemed like, and maybe it was because of us and the hype machine that always is leading up to the trade deadline, it just felt like, Jake Gensel was going to get a ridiculous return. Noah Hanifin, I mean, go down the list of all the high-quality players. And then you see the trades, and you're like, all right, I guess it's okay. But it kind of feels like there was more left out there. But that obviously wasn't the case. It just wasn't the case.
And so when you look back at the work Craig Connery's done in the last 12 months, he had 7 UFAs. He's dealt with 6 of them. He extended Backlund. He's traded 5. And he's got obviously Oliver Shillington, a very unique situation to deal with this summer. What have we learned about the Flames' new GM in less than a year on the job and what he's been able to do or failed to do, I suppose, depending on how you want to look at it?
Well, he's not afraid to get his hands dirty, and he's a man true to his word. When he accepted the job, he talked about how difficult it was, to see Johnny Gaudreau walk out for nothing and to be positioned in the way that they were, where they quite literally had a team that Matthew Tkachuk was going to go to. And obviously that's the Florida Panthers. And he learned from that experience of trying to never pigeonhole yourself. Right. Mm-hmm. And so in saying that, I think he did pretty well across the board. I do. I wonder about, it's not easy when you're trading expiring contracts because they're good players. They're good players. And the fan base always thinks that you should get more. But as we've already established, I think what we learned in this year's trade deadline is, for the most part here, not with every team, most teams weren't willing to pay the premium price for the rental market, right?
Yeah.
So, Conroy and others were dealing with a weakened hand. But he did it. And he stayed true to his word. And he acquired some useful pieces and future assets and all of that. But doesn't it kind of feel like the heavy lifting is going to happen in the summer here?
Funny because we say, this busy first year, all these free agents. Yeah. And then you start looking at the summer, you're like, well, shoot, that could be a Markstrom deal. And man, it looks like they got too many wingers. And oh my gosh, like they're going to the draft with lots of assets and picks. And then, geez, Kuzmenko and Sharon Govich are up next year and Mangiapane. Yeah. Like it doesn't stop for Craig yet.
It doesn't. And look, we haven't even, thrown a twist into all of this. And, and I'm not predicting this is going to happen, but it's fair that we talk about it because we've mentioned it before. If you're Nazem Kadri, maybe you don't love the idea of spending the next 4 or 5 years, trying to transition this organization. Huberto is a little bit different. That contract's borderline immovable. It's immovable. And unless you apply the sweeteners necessary and all that and you get the salary. Anyway, it doesn't matter. But I do think aside from the contracts that he's going to have to wrestle with, there are going to be some very difficult situations that he's going to have to manage. And it probably starts with Jacob Markstrom, right? I mean, if Markstrom decides, and let's see how it plays out here. If Calgary can keep things on the rails and they play well, I mean, he's dealing with something. We know that.
Yeah.
But maybe he has a change of heart. Maybe things settle down for him. And he buys into what Craig Conroy and management are selling in the belief that there can be a shorter-term transition here. Well, maybe that all kind of goes by the wayside. I'm not so sure it will.
Do you think that's what
it will?
Do you think that's what Conroy wants? Is a short? I mean, obviously, he always wanted to get back to playoffs. But
yeah,
with the assets he's accrued, the opening, some salary cap space, you know the situation pretty damn well. Is there enough there to spin it right away? You've got the goaltender. You've got the goaltender. Now, you don't want to give up on Hanifin, but Hanifin chose to leave.
Right.
And you probably had to trade. Lindholm didn't want to be there. Do you have, from what we've seen, there's a bunch of kids there that are doing pretty damn good.
Agreed.
Is there a way of spinning this around real quick?
And like, is that in the best interest? Yeah. Is that in the best interest of the Calgary Flames? I think that there are some pretty profile people around that organization who have made a strong case that the best path for the Calgary Flames is to go through a pretty significant renovation, right? Like that's how you build a much better foundation for a brighter future. But man, it's difficult. You know, look around the league here. And I don't know that Calgary needs a full scale. I think that based on some of the assets that they acquired, I mean, when you look at the number of draft picks, whether it's this year, it's next year, it's the year after, I always chuckle when I look at, you know, let's use Arizona as an example. You can't sign the number of draft picks that the Arizona Coyotes have.
Right.
You're just not going to in any one given year. So you do use them as currency. And I'm sure that Conroy and other teams will do exactly that. But again, be careful what you wish for. You know, if you're one of those who believe that the Calgary Flames need a rebuild, because look at the Detroit Red Wings as an example. What is this, year seven, year eight? And you're talking about a pretty experienced and shrewd manager. Well, first it was Kenny Holland who initiated the rebuild. And then obviously Steve Yzerman takes over. You know, Winnipeg, the very reason they decided to go all in and convinced Scheifele and Hellebuck to extend is because they felt like they had the pieces there they could work with, provided those two star pieces stayed in the organization. Well, they only did that after talking to the Detroit Red Wings and some of the teams that went full-scale rebuild. Smaller markets, and I don't know, I wouldn't call Calgary a smaller market, but it's a Canadian market, obviously. You know, try and get your fan base to buy into a 5 to 8 year rebuild.
Yeah.
It's hard. It might be in the best interest of what's good long-term hockey-wise, but try and make that reality. It's almost impossible in Canada.
It's also a weird team to do that with the names that you mentioned.
They've got some vets that might not let you bottom out that hard.
No.
But they've also got some kids that are already arriving and you haven't quite even started this thing yet. Like, not Buffalo, right? This is very much not the Oilers' decade of darkness, nor the Buffalo 15 years, because you have very good players that are arriving already.
And Buffalo's approach, I always say it because I'm in Buffalo, they wanted McDavid.
Yeah.
Maybe the best ever. And they missed on a bingo ball. Like, so.
Yeah, they had the worst year by a mile that year.
Right? Like, their plan was completely different than what they're playing out. So, anyway.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah, I'm with you, man. But then look at a team like the San Jose Sharks, right? So when Doug Wilson was there, he was as good as any at finding a way to keep that balance there. I mean, you had the graybeards like Joe Thornton, you know, but then he'd make a trade here or there, and you keep it relevant. And all of a sudden, you think, oh, this has got to be the year the San Jose Sharks go backwards. And then, no, hold on. You know, they make a push. They get in the playoffs. And all of a sudden, now you're looking at something far more interesting. Well, you know, by design this year, Mike Greer and the San Jose Sharks are doing what they can do. I don't know. I look at Calgary for all the things that we've already talked about. I keep hearing that there are people who are pushing Conroy to dig deeper into rebuild mode. Mm-hmm. And I'm not so sure that's the right approach.
I think we're just talking about Markstrom here, aren't we? Like, really? Isn't that it? If they keep Markstrom, it's a retool. If they trade Markstrom, it's a rebuild. Isn't that where we draw the line?
Well, yeah, I think so. But is that where you draw the line? And if you draw the line, draw it in pencil. Because again, you know, if you trade Jacob Markstrom, are you sure that Kadri or one of the pieces that you're going to need to help shepherd those young guys into a place where, again, you're nibbling, you're contending? I mean, he's under contract, so he's going to honor that contract. But Markstrom is so pivotal and key, I think, to keeping that transition competitive. And you know, you, sometimes you fall in love with how things look. And again, I'm gonna reflect back to Detroit. Detroit looked like they were a playoff team at the midpoint of the season, certainly in the first half of the year. And because of that, you know, they kind of kept their powder dry. Eisenman has made some changes and all of that over the last couple of seasons, obviously. But, you know, if your goalie is there, it covers up a whole lot of flaws. We know this. And it allows you to make some decisions where you're bringing in younger players. And again, that renovation on the fly is palatable. The fan base can buy into that. If the goalie isn't there, I'm not so sure. I think it gets tough on everyone.
It's an interesting mix too, because if Markstrom strays, Wolf's got someone to mentor under.
You can have success.
Yeah. The one I want to ask you, because it's interesting to me, because in Buffalo here, everybody's excited about the playoff push and the play of Bo and Byram. And I looked at, we talked about Bo and Byram, you know, as maybe not even being available, but I don't even, what do you think? And I always bring it back to Calgary.
Yeah.
Is Bo and Byram available for Lindholm? Because I feel like if that trade's made, that immediately changes what they're doing next year again, right? Like,
I mean, I don't know that, Rhett. You know, Byram's name was out there. In hindsight, we should add him way higher up on all trade bait graphics. Based on the quality of the player. And when you look at the Colorado Avalanche and the design of that blue line, you can appreciate why he would be a player in play. And his name has been out there for a couple of seasons. But watching him now in Buffalo, it's like he was born to be there, man. Yes. Like because he's playing in a position, in a role, where he's got more responsibility and he can play the game that he's capable of playing. And he's not necessarily playing behind anyone. Of course, you know, there's a dynamic in Buffalo, but it was different in Colorado. And I, you know, Kevin Adams to me, so Kelly McCrimmon for me wins deadline because of all the work that was done around deadline, not just because he brings in Hanifin and he brings in Matha, but that hurdle trade was next level. That's just next level management right there. I would say Kevin Cheveldayoff off of the Winnipeg Jets is up there too, you know, with Monahan and then Toffoli and the work that they did. But that trade in Buffalo, Colorado, I mean, Kevin Adams played that perfectly because Casey Mittelstadt he's a quality player, but he just didn't seem to be there in Buffalo. He just never, you know, they'd give him more opportunity and he just couldn't find a way to run with it. So hopefully it works out for him in Colorado, but that's a good old fashioned hockey trade again, where you give up quality to get quality back. But to acquire Bo Byram from Casey Mittelstadt, Kevin Adams deserves a ton of credit. That was a shrewd move.
Feels like a deal both teams can win too. I mean, the Avs made it a priority to upgrade on Ryan Johansson at center ice in the second line, and you could argue they've done that. And if you were waiting for Casey Mittelstadt to pop, this has been the closest to the years we kind of expected since drafting in the first round. I could see both teams loving this deal. Maybe not quite the same as the Neuendijk Ginla in this market, but the teams had different needs, different timelines, different phases of a life cycle. It might work for both of them, no?
Agreed. No, I 100% agree with that. You know, it's always dangerous when you're trying to predict Stanley Cup champions at any time of the year. You know, this time of year, we're starting to get a better look, obviously, as the standings kind of materialize. That Colorado team, fellas.
We just saw it. They're out west right now. It is a wagon.
And I was asked a question. We did a regional game last night, Toronto and the Philadelphia Flyers, and one of the quiz questions was, who's the best player in the league? You know, and their options were, as you'd expect, Connor McDavid, Austin Matthews, Nathan MacKinnon. I took Nathan MacKinnon, and only because it's right now. I think Connor McDavid is the best player in the game, but right now, you know, in that Wednesday game, as an example, against the Vancouver Canucks, when Talk at postgame said it was like Nate MacKinnon just said, I'm taking this game, and he did it in the third period, and he's surrounded by it. All world players. I mean, spend 30 seconds watching Mikko Rantanen play. Holy smokes. Yes. Like, they're so good. And then, you know, all the pieces that they brought in. John Walker seemingly gets forgotten about in the transactions that Colorado made. They get terrific ad, which explains why you had the flexibility and the freedom to move a player as quality as Bo Byram. So that West, I mean, all the teams in the East who feel like they're good, they feel like they're Stanley Cup contenders, they're looking at that West, probably looking at the Central Division, hoping that they just eat each other alive.
That 2-3. I mean, you could theoretically have...
It's nuts.
It could be Dallas, Colorado, round one. Like, those might be the two best teams in the West. Like, that's crazy. I can't wait for it. I know people like to wring their hands in certain markets when it happens to their team, but all it means is you get an incredible first round series right out of the gate. And like,
agreed.
As for entertainment value, it dominates. I love the format. Some quick hitters before we let you go. Really quickly, what do you know about a timeline for Tomáš Hertl, that big ad for Vegas? He's one of four guys missing for them right now. Stone's done for the year, regular season for sure. Martinez, we didn't really know. Carrier's out. What's Hertl's timeline?
Well, they're hoping that he'll be available 10 days to a week before the end of the regular season. Okay. So, and it, you know, if that's the case, that's huge for them, because at least it, you know, he'll be skating and all that, but at least it gives him a little bit of a chance to get his NHL game back intact. So they'll be healthy at the right time. Stone is questionable for the playoffs, but they'll have some interesting pieces back in the mix.
Okay, another couple of quick hitters. You mentioned Colorado. It makes me think, which contender has improved the most from a week ago before the deadline, let's call it? Is it Colorado that you like the most? And that's not to say they're going to win it, but that addressed the needs that they had. Like, I still thought Edmonton needs another D. They didn't get one. I
mean, right, I'm with you. I'm with you on that. You know, it's a bit of a three-way race here. Winnipeg did a lot. They did in bringing in Monahan and Toffoli. And now all of a sudden you see a top 10 pick like Cole Perfetti fighting to stay in the lineup, right? Wow. You know, he's a fourth line winger, drafted 10th overall. And look, adversity helps young players, so he'd better accept it and he better meet the challenge. They're really good, but I cannot look by Colorado. And there's a chance that Gabriel Landeskog will play in the playoffs as well.
You know, they say not before May, but potentially
probably
May.
Probably not before the second round, but he can't be as good as he was when he left, you know, with the Stanley Cup in 2022, but just having him around and playing as hard as he plays, holy smokes. I mean, that'll feel like another blockbuster for the Avs.
Just slide that guy in your second line. Goodness. They're also without Lekkonen right now, who's been ill, but will be back. I think like it's crazy what they and that Vancouver game, second half of a back-to-back. That team is scary right now.
Really?
Finally, just to put a bow on all things Calgary Flames, we talk about rebuild, retool, long-term, short-term, run it back, sell more. Do you feel like the sweet spot, if you could walk the tight wire, is to be back into a competitive near contender status by the time the new building arrives, fall 2027? Or is that too aggressive a timeline for you?
No, I think that's doable. You know, again, you have to look at the good young pieces that they currently have, the work that you expect that Conroy is going to do, and all of those things. So, I reserve judgment. I'm hesitating because I want to see how much more gets done in the offseason. So it's a difficult question to answer in March without knowing, you know, what some of the action is going to look like around the draft. We say this every year, as much as we look forward to the trade deadline, and then you've got, you know, July 1st free agent frenzy, the draft has become more of a melting pot and a mecca for big level trades than any other event over the course of the year. And maybe Calgary's deeply involved at that point.
Yeah, we saw the Weber-Subban. We saw the Hall-Larson one-for-one. Toffoli went the eve of the draft last year. I think you're absolutely right. And maybe could they be contenders is the wrong question. Best-case scenario probably is that. If you wanted to walk that tightrope, that's probably, if you talk to ownership, GM players, there's your best case. Go chase it.
Yeah, more flexibility financially in the system too, right? So that's why it gets that active.
Dregs, have a great weekend. We do appreciate you coming on every week with us. And I know it's been chaos, but you've earned some downtime for insiders, if there's such a thing.
I'll flip you guys some pictures of me in a Speedo on the beach in Florida next week.
You can send those to Boomer. That's great. Yeah, he'll handle those. Thanks, Dregs.
Yeah, guys, have a good one.
Darren Dreger on the TELUS Insider Hotline, of course, presented by TELUS. You can enter to win one of six monthly prizes, including tickets to Calgary hockey games and awesome tech like AirPods, Apple Watches, and more. No purchase necessary. Just go to the website, telus.com/flamescontest. What do you make all that? A lot of flames amongst the league stuff.
I think he's going to try and thread the needle a little bit, Conroy. I don't think he can tear it down. And I think
not a full one, right?
No. Nope.
Yeah.
No. Nope. And it might be the wisest because, you know, we've said, you, myself, I think Boom has been in agreement that the fans in Calgary will come out and watch. If you put in effort like they have this year, mm-hmm. even if you're not successful, they'll still come out and watch. They'll still support the team. If you're competing and putting in the effort, we'll come watch young kids. We'll watch them fail. But for how long?
Yeah, you have to believe that this process is going
to
work.
Right? Yeah. There has to be a path to success. And I just wonder if he's done a good enough job. I'm stuck on this, and I'm overplaying it. And I'm probably overplaying it because of the way Byram's played here in Buffalo. And I went and watched him play, and I'm like, Jesus, yeah, he looks pretty good. Stud. And if he was available and you could have got him for Lindholm, and I don't even know, I almost wonder if that immediately, now you're back to having three stud defensemen that solidifies all that. You don't have a hole there. I don't know what Kuzmenko is going to turn out to be.
Right.
I just wonder if he could have got him. I think that immediately puts him back into maybe not next year, but the year after, we're going to be close. All the
assets, also made. Yeah, sir. Go ahead.
So I'll just finish what my general thought is. He's done well enough in asset management that he's got the currency to make moves to not stay shitty for long.
Yeah. Yeah. And Dreger alluded to that. Like, just because you have 4 second-round picks, let's say, doesn't mean you draft them all. You don't. It would be silly. You only have a certain number of contracts. You don't want a lot of the guys of the same age clogging the system. Look at where the LA Kings were last year. They had all kinds of organizational depth, and the Arizona Coyotes had lots of picks, and they said, we'll take Sean Durzi. We're not going to use that pick. We'll give you the pick. We'll take the player. And then Arizona went to Minnesota a couple of years ago and said, we'll take this college free agent that may or may not want to sign in Minnesota, Jack McBain, you take this second rounder. And that to me is like, everyone's like, well, how are the Flames going to find a defenseman? What are you going to find in free agency? Like, well, they got lots of picks. If you take that second to the market this summer and find a team in a cap pinch or someone that's tumbled on a depth chart.
Yes.
Why couldn't you find next year's Sean Durzi to play on the second pair with Shillington? Right. Well, and
Byram's a great example of a guy that was stuck in a spot where he wasn't going to get ahead of it.
Totally.
You got to look for those pieces and trust that you're right in the evaluation of what you think those players are. And if you feel they're the right fit and the right piece, go get it.
And it's not nearly the same level because Byram's an incredibly highly touted prospect. But Miramanov is a guy that was stacked in Vegas. Couldn't play. It's like he's played 29 games in 3 years. You don't want to lose him on waivers. He returns from injury. You can't play him. You can't send him down because you'll lose him. What do you do? Well, Conroy says, look, I'll go see what this guy is. I'm going to give him ice time for a couple of years, and maybe he's something, maybe he's not. But that's sort of isolating someone that's stuck on a depth chart. It's deals like that. Because Michael's a similar thing, although the salary was an important factor in that deal with Vancouver. But go find skilled players that are in just weird spots. See if you can't. Look, there's like, how much ice time is this guy getting now? Like, he went from 29 games of 3 years to like top 4 minutes. Like that. I don't know if it's going to work or not, but I like that he's trying it. You'll know by the end of next year whether this guy was a throwaway depth piece or it's like, shit, you found a defenseman that wasn't even going to play there. That's a nice get. Last night, by the way, 20 minutes again, 20:53. It's back-to-back games over 20 minutes. This guy's hardly played in 3 years.
That's what I'm talking about. I think he's going to try and maneuver down that real narrow path and not be Deadsville forever. Calgary's I don't give a shit what anyone says. Calgary's a tough, I don't like free agency to begin with, but Calgary's a real tough market if you go 5 years without the playoffs.
It's not how you rebuild. You don't rebuild through free agency. It's an irrelevant thing. What you're collecting is assets under team control, right? And that's why immediately they extend Miramanov after that deal. That's why they're targeting a 20-year-old defenseman. Like, they're trying to find guys that for 4 or 5 years, they have. And then when these players come up into free agents years, you hope you're a contender and they want to hang around. They feel like they're part of a culture that's been built here. I just think winning's the biggest piece. And you're a player, you would know. The money's going to be close everywhere. Winning is the biggest piece, generally speaking. If you're going to be bad, of course Calgary's not going to recruit well. But Florida right. couldn't recruit 5 years ago, and that's no taxes, great climate. You need the winning piece.
Yeah, winning is a great equalizer for all.
Yeah. Okay. Boy, we've got a lot to get to today. Dino gone today. He's left us a little something. I do want to get to that. Big thank you, by the way, to Dregs. That's good stuff. You're not an insider. Hey? You said you're not. That's not the path you chose.
I don't like titles. I just I do a lot.
Renaissance man. That's the only title you seem comfortable with.
Fashion
Jack of all trades, master
fashion model tonight.
Fashion model. Any jewelry? Do you think you'll be rocking?
No, I didn't win any, tonight? So I don't have any.
Well, maybe you could borrow the Shoveler's Vina Nova diamonds, the lab grown ones. That's I feel like you could, this is the night to bling in Buffalo.
She doesn't share.
Sweatpants for the coffee shop, bling at the fashion show. That's got to be the move. Are you bringing a date or are you going on your own here?
No, the date is she's a coming. Big night out.
Okay. Well, she could be flashing her diamonds, her Vina Nova diamonds tonight at the fashion show. And a reminder, why are you spending on earth mine diamonds when lab grown diamonds are exact same character and composition? At a fraction of the price, as little as 20% of the cost in some instances. Vina Nova's Calgary's only all lab grown diamond shop. And our boy Justin there is going to get you set up, whether it's a proposal, custom ring building. You know, we like girls like diamonds, birthdays, anniversaries, a lot of anniversaries in the summer, Rhett. We get married in the summer typically.
Yeah, they like summer weddings, don't they?
It's better that way. Were you a fall? I recall your anniversary being near mine.
I just
fall.
Ran away.
What's that? Vina Nova.com for more, or check out the downtown showroom on the second level of Stephen Avenue Place. Vina Nova. Check it out. Blinging tonight. Flames. I can't hear you. I'm sorry. I keep talking over
flames.
You.
Go again. Flames, go.
Montreal. I'm excited. Ovi, and then the great wait. I wonder if... you don't tell Jacob Markstrom. See that calendar there? I don't care if you're ready for tomorrow. We're giving you a full week. Get ready for Vancouver, your old team, next weekend.
Yeah, we're not risking anything. You come back against Vancouver. Take a nice break.
And the ulterior motive, Rhett, would be?
See the kids? Well, it's not even our... We're pretending that this is sneaky. It's like the most obvious thing in the world. Yeah, we're not going to play. We're going to get some of these games in, these kids in these games, and let's see how he does here. Like,
I just think it ties so into that Dreger conversation because, you know, six games in, you don't know what anyone is in this league, never mind a goalie. But if you somehow, some way got a very comfortable level of confidence with Dustin Wolf's game at this level, that could change how you approach the summer, or too small of a sample can't change it.
Well, it is a small sample, but picture Kiprusoff coming to town. I don't bring him up because he's one of the best ever. They just retired his jersey. What did we know after 20 games with Kiprusoff?
This guy's fucking awesome.
Play him.
Right? Don't ever not play him.
And yes.
Daryl did for 7 years.
Yeah. It can be too much of a small sample size, or it can be a fucking the light goes on. It's like, oh, okay, we've got the guy. Let's go.
Yeah.
We don't need to worry about any other goalies. We've got him.
And I'm not, I think it would be very, very unlikely that, you know, a 21-year-old or whatever Wolf is could do that. But to just say, oh my God, like he's arrived. This is the guy. But I would love to see Wolf and Vladar. Show us what you got here, fellas. And if you see enough from those two where you're like, fuck, Vladar battles hard. The soft goals are kind of going away a little bit. Man, Wolf just doesn't get shaken. There's just some poise there that really is a unique skill set. You often see young goalies shrivel or the moment's too big. That's just not for him. If you sort of had those kind of marks from these two goalies down the stretch, those kinds of like reports from your scouts watching, just the auras they're giving off, you're like, you know what? Let's go turn Markstrom into a great young hockey player or another first or both.
Best case scenario, Wolf's undeniably good.
Yeah.
And you can move on from any goaltender because you know you've got your guy. Second best scenario is he's good enough and Vladar looks good enough. We can muddy our way through this. It's not going to be picture perfect, but we could still turn Markstrom into an asset. Worst case scenario, and it's not even a bad scenario, is you keep Markstrom and Wolf together, and he's got a guy to learn under. Like, it, Conroy's in a pretty good spot, I think.
The if these guys play well, he sure is. Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
If they play well.
And that's what you'd love to have.
You have a guy in Markstrom, as long as he's happy and content to come back, that you can mentor Wolf under. That's your worst case scenario.
What are we talking about?
This is what we're going to complain about?
Yeah. And maybe it's not. Maybe you're like, shit, you know what? Like, I remember Joe Colburn almost scoring 20 in every fourth goal going in, and you don't want to put too much stock in some of these meaningless games down the stretch. Okay, we'll come back. And it's Markstrom Wolf, and you're like, in January, shit, Wolf, he's ready. Now you've got a Markstrom at the deadline, and you're selling two playoff runs. You could do it there if you wanted to, in theory, right?
Not the worst thing.
Yeah. Dino's left us a gift. I don't know if you know that.
Oh, he always does.
He's out of town, and we are jacked to have one of our old staples of the old job, roll up the rim to win, Tim Hortons 60th anniversary. They are back, and we're going to roll some highlights of the week, courtesy Tim Hortons. Reminder, don't forget to participate in Roll Up the Rim to Win. Celebrate the big year, the 60th anniversary, some big prizes available, an all-electric Volkswagen ID4, a sun-soaked Hilton getaway, and cash with a daily jackpot of $10,000. You got to play on the app, Rhett. You need the Tim's app. Get in there. Roll, roll, roll. Let's get at her. So we will roll out the highlights of the week, courtesy Boom Boom and Tim Hortons.
Go to the box, please. Go to the box, please. Now. Vancouver Kelly, 43, 2 minute minor interference.
He's trying to get back to his skates, and now the Rangers have a 2-on-0. It's Panarin, Trocheck, Kochetkov, the end. What a save!
Two on the back check. Centering pass by Fiala. Block. Fiala gets it back to the net. Can he shoot? Yes! Score! What an effort! Kevin Fiala! Kings win it!
And Gudas has just landed one on Mackenzie Entwistle, who's trying to protect himself. And Peter Mrazek stepping in to try and break things up with Gudas.
And here comes Gibson. Let's see what we got here. Let's see what we got.
Reese Johnson battling Pavel Minyakov right now. And Gibson is trying to grab at Mrazek.
That was a surprising one there. Gibson wants to grab the goalie. He's telling the referee, let's go.
Rhett was always the best at the can opener. The can opener with the push. That's what it was. The can opener with the push. And the minute that left the game, you know, Rhett knew it was time. That was it.
Poke check back across the line by Kyle Connor. They started the period really well. Oh, bouncing puck.
Score! Ooh. What a play! Nyquist through the legs on the drop pass to Forsberg.
Overthinking, Nyquist is going to shoot this one, and a nice little touch pass and Forsberg into the empty net at point. Right to his line mate, Gus Nyquist, for that beautiful play.
On Decades Night, Bennington playing like it's 2019.
Oh. He looks like, with these jerseys, he's playing like he's Curtis Joseph.
Wow, what a save there. And then the follow-up, I think he stacks the pads.
Faber change.
John Hines to pull the goaltender. And the Wild win it in overtime.
Left-hand flow to set up the beautiful pump fake.
Mwah.
Kyrie is one of those guys. If the right one don't get you, then the left one will.
The beauty of being amphibious.
Jimmy was coaching, and he put me on in overtime, and Tony Monty was yelling at him on the bench. Why in the F are we putting him on the ice? And then the funny part about it is J.P. Dumont, who I played with in Buffalo, he's on the ice for Nashville, and he's lined up against me. And he's talked to me about this. He goes, as soon as I saw you were out there, I was like, yes. I lined up in front of the net with him.
Yeah.
And he's like, he told his center, just chip it past this guy and I'll blow by him and I'll have a breakaway. We're good. So he sprint, he just leaves off the draw and he's got me beaten. And we kind of, it kind of wasn't a clean win and we kind of win it. And it comes to the net and I happen to tip it and it goes in. So it was brilliant by Jimmy Playfair.
That's it for this week's edition of Roll It. For Tim Hortons, we got to go. You're not going. You're mad. Okay. But it's a once a week segment. We only have so much time. There's only so much time. You're not. It's Tim. Okay. Well, now you're mad. I don't want you to be mad. Now you're mad. What are you mad about? And you're swearing. Roll up the rim. You'll feel better. We'll see you next week.
Don Tortorella has been tossed.
Ah, great stuff and boom boom there. Love it. A lot of good stuff. That's just this week.
That was.
I still can't get over the Rhett, like he just got away with one. Oh, like okay. Farting in church.
What am I doing out here? You see that?
And Rhett Warner is scored. Rhett Warner. Warner.
Man, I was a good player.
It's just great on the ice, great in the room.
Do it all, really.
Great everywhere, buddy. Great on the team here. Love you. There it is for Tim Hortons. Letter roll. A reminder to get that app. That's how we're rolling these days. 60th anniversary. Penn report time. I do want to say thank you to everyone trying to help with the Penn report. The issue I'm now finding is I have 30 to 50 people on Instagram sending me the same crocodile videos every goddamn day.
Do you want to hear something crazy?
Yes.
Jack, you got to look this up. In one of the towns around here, like, you know, they're all, it's not like Calgary where the whole area is one big city.
Right.
There's little towns like Amherst and Orchard Park, and yep, one of the towns is Hamburg.
Okay.
Today, the news coming out of Hamburg, an 11-foot alligator got taken out of a guy's house. He didn't have
Jeez.
The right. It got. Ah. Yes. 750 pounder. What?
You know what? It's like, oh, it's cute. Look at this little baby alligator, and you're on vacation in Florida. Like, why don't we just put him in this little Tupperware and bring him home? No big deal. Next thing you know, this fucker's 11 feet, 750 pounds. What do you do? Oh, Rhett. So many crocodiles and alligators. I never knew before the Penn report started that this was a thing. Let's get to it. I believe we have snake. Gator. Yeah, we got lots of good stuff in here. Turtle bite. That's a good one. It's all coming up. Read it out loud for us. Look at the size of that.
It's a big bite. Oh, what does it say? It really was a see you later alligator moment for one homeowner in Hamburg. On Wednesday, the Department of Environmental Conservation seized an 11-foot, 750-pound alligator that had numerous health issues from a home in Hamburg. Jesus, people.
Lucky that you're not the one with health issues. Like 11 feet. You're talking like tip to tail, higher than a basketball net, significantly.
That's big.
Oh.
Jackie's got it pulled up there. If that's what you want roaming around the house, I guess go get one.
I got to send you this Aussie Northern Territory Outback guy with the crocodiles. It's phenomenal stuff. 750 pounds. Oh yeah, that's quite a domestic pet. Yikes. Okay, let's get into it. It's for Village Honda in the Northwest Auto Mall, online at villagehonda.com. New in stock inventory on the ground. Start your automotive.
Start again.
We have new in stock inventory on the ground. Start your automotive adventures at Village Honda, where new vehicle pricing is MSRP. Major Slick Ryan Pinder. That's what that stands for, I'm sure. Let's get to it. We start with the Calgary Flames. Last night's afterburner, the debut of Mike Gold, our writing pal at Flames Nation, and Cammy breaking it down.
That's Ivan Barbashev coming down on the breakaway, and you know that's not a slouch. He's got 38 points this season. He was a huge part of their Stanley Cup last year. That's not a guy who you necessarily want to have bearing down on you. That's a terrific save.
Now, this was his first start since February 15th, where he had some stinkers. He also got hung out to dry with some truly atrocious turnovers by his teammates. But 28-29.
I mean, that's fantastic stuff. I mean, that's the sort of thing that we've become accustomed to seeing from Dustin Wolf to an extent in the American League level. You know, the funny thing is watching Dustin Wolf of the last, I guess, four seasons now, when it rains, it can pour. And I was at his first pro game when they were playing in the COVID bubble here in the Saddle Dome. Was rough. And he had, I think he gave up 5 goals and he was pulled. And Wolf after that was stellar in his 2 games after that. But he's very resilient. This game was a statement.
It's a big win for the kid, as we talked about earlier in the show. Great work from Mike and Cammy last night. If you want more on the Vegas loss here in Calgary to the Flames, Afterburner sitting right there for you. Wherever you get your pods, go get it. Go, go. Wildcard looks like this, Rhett. Let's take a peek at the old standings. Vegas wildcard too. That just doesn't feel right. A win would have had them go past Los Angeles in that last night. Instead, they stay in wildcard two. And I don't know who's wearing the Nashville Predators jerseys right now, Rhett, but will they ever lose again? I don't know.
They're a juggernaut.
Apparently. Schedule is as such, 2 games and a big break. It is Montreal tomorrow, always a blast when the Habs pass through town, and then Washington Monday for Ovechkin's only visit, and then all next week, off days, reload, get out to Vancouver for a Saturday game. We will be at Greta. Tickets are on sale at nationgear.ca. Join us at Greta next Saturday for that road game. It'll be a blast. Already some interesting RSVPs for Saturday night. And I want to get Pike with a bookshelf there. Sell some books, Pike. Jack did put up the link for
Pike's books, the Pike Bomb.
It's not called Pike Bombs. It probably should be. I'm going to talk to the publisher if we can.
Oh, I hope it's not
that called changed. Pike Bombs.
Bombs either.
Dean told you yesterday, bobblehead's gone missing for Jaromir Jagr. He's hanging on Pittsburgh a bunch. He's been doing some stuff with them, and I don't know who did this. I don't appreciate this. This is not nice. I'm here in Calgary. I have nothing to do with anything being stolen in Pittsburgh. So, Jack, who does socials here? This is not acceptable.
Bobby Germany.
Bobby, settle down.
Wasn't this all like a big hoax or something?
It started to look like it. Yeggs is driving around saying, I got to find these guys. And I got one in riding shotgun with me. You're like, is this how we do things after a crime has been reported? Or I feel like they're doing a little theater here, Rhett. Oh, yeah, we lost these. Hey, maybe we'll send Jagr to go find them.
I never understood.
Take a camera crew with you.
Yeah, I never understood, like, if you were in the theft game or industry, what are you doing with them?
You mean if you're a crook? You're a thief?
Hey,
the theft industry.
You steal a van full of microwaves? Yeah, you can hawk them. Bobbleheads? Yeah, I don't know. But gritty, though.
There's people who would know. I don't know. I mean, I have no experience. I don't have much time in the theft industry, personally. But we'll see. Tonight's slate, only 2.
Eggs from the gas store when you were younger, for sure.
No. These are stinkers. If you want the odds, Rhett, Winnipeg is -405 at home against Anaheim. That is a heavy favorite. Believe it's Laurent Brossoit going tonight. Hellebuck's played the last 2. Ducks are no good. We'll revisit this game in my Betway Bets of the Day. The other contest has the Kings and Hawks. This used to be one of the best playoff series you could watch. Between 2010 and, I want to say, 2016, these teams clashed. And whoever won, if they played, typically won the cup. It was that good. It was the Sutter, Kings, 2 cups, and the Kane, Taves, Keith, Quenville dynasty. On the other side, it's not quite the same hype tonight.
That was good hockey.
Oof. God, was it? It was big boy hockey.
So good.
Kings might have been the heaviest, most physical team, and they played with that Darryl defensive structure. And the Hawks just had this incredible blend of skill and offensive ruthlessness. But also, you know, like your Chalmersons and your big bodies. And oh, man. Like 2 very, very different teams, but were the best of those mid-2010s, early 2010s.
Back and forth. I remember that one. It was like L.A. just wouldn't let it go. Go down tired, win in overtime. Whoa.
Unreal. I can't wait for playoffs. I really can't. I'm very excited about this. Mm-hmm. By the way, if you were at last year's playoff draft, the Barnburner playoff draft, the inaugural, the second annual is happening.
Pay attention.
If you are a team GM, we have sent emails out. You have a small window to secure and renew your spot in the draft. Anything left over, we'll take to market. I have very, very
We will dump you like a bad habit if you're not ready to jump on this.
So large queue of people waiting to join the draft, but you were there last year. Make sure
we
you
love you. Respond. We want you back. But if you're going to dilly-dally and not answer emails or text messages, what kind of person are you?
Good question, Rhett. And what kind of repercussions would there be? Do you think they should be suspended if they don't respond to maybe a third request email?
You're going
to
miss out on things. You're going to miss out. I got an email late last night that said, "We're sorry you couldn't join us for the Zoom meeting." I'm like, wait a minute. I did join the Zoom meeting.
I was going to say, you didn't miss email. That after all that. Oh, you're in the wrong email.
I used the wrong email.
But do you let them know and you're not suspended, or you are suspended?
Cruised right through. Signed in this morning. Not a word said.
You are despicable. Just answer your any emails. Let's get some football. You're the big Bills guy. We know Jack's the big Steelers guy. Boomer's pretending to be a Bears guy. My Chargers have had a rough couple days here. Eckler gone. They traded Keenan Allen yesterday. They cut Mike Williams. That apparently is an offense, and I don't know that that's any good.
Doesn't look great. I like the quarterback.
It's early. Very early. There's got to be a bunch of big names left in free agency, right, Jack? What are we looking at here? There's got to be some superstar ready to go to L.A. and be a superstar.
Tyler Boyd?
Oh.
Odell Beckham Jr.?
No. 5 years ago, maybe.
ODB.
OBJ.
One of those guys in Cincinnati, doesn't he want out?
That's T. Higgins. Go get T.
T.
That's exactly what they should do. Go get T. Lock him up. And there's your big target for Herbert. And then take. They got a fifth overall pick. Get that Marvin Harrison Jr. Convince everyone else not to take him.
Better yet, we'll get T in Buffalo.
Okay.
You take Diggs.
Yeah.
It's He needs a change of scenery. Everybody's like happy.
Yeah. We will get to your Bills in a moment, but first the Bears. Now, they traded number one overall to Carolina last year so they could take Bryce Young, right?
Yes.
Miserable year. Carolina was awful. They got so much back in that pick, and they keep adding to it because they swapped one of the picks involved for Keenan Allen yesterday. So for the first overall pick last year, O-tackle, Pro Bowl wide receiver, cornerback, another Pro Bowl caliber wide receiver in DJ Moore. First overall pick this year and a second next year. Can we get Connie to call the Bears GM and figure out how to do this and some work?
Asset management right there.
Mayor asset management. That is masterclass. That's some chestnut checkers right there, Rhett. Oh! And they could have just stayed where they were, Carolina, and probably taken Stroud, if I'm correct. Oof. Speaking of your Bills, they got a little weapon here. Curtis Samuel, the gadget guy. Carry the ball, catch the ball, line up in the backfield. This is an interesting add to the Bills offense, and he's got some history with offensive coordinator Joe Brady. Okay.
Apparently, the folks in Buffalo through the moon about this.
Through the moon.
Over the moon and back and through. Is there a through the something? Did I screw it up? Change the word. Through thick and thin and moons. We love you, Sammy.
Oh, welcome to town. Lighting in a bucket.
Just pump.
Truth is in the pudding.
Yeah.
Through the moon. I love you. That's amazing. Okay. You want to see a good club toss from a good Canadian boy?
You're damn right I do.
Players Championships ongoing in Florida. This course is a beast. There is water everywhere. And this is Adam Hadwin, one of a very nice stable of Canadian players on the tour these days. I feel like we're at like 8 to 10 really good Canadians on tour. Hadwin's having a tough go. He had just put it in the water the hole prior. Let's pick things up here. I believe this is 18. Ooh, in the drink on 17, nearly in the water on the tee shot, then rolls in. And you know what? I'm done this round. I don't need that club anymore.
I think he was just trying to find a swing there.
Yeah, it looks smooth.
Yeah.
I wondered if there was a gator. So he's just trying to defend himself.
Yeah.
Strike the gator.
We love you, Hadwin. Don't worry about it. We're with you.
We're with you, buddy. Okay, dumb shit. Let's go. Street soccer. Get ready for World Cup 2026. It's coming to Canada, USA, and Mexico, and people will be all over the streets celebrating the beauty that is the beautiful game, footy. Can we have a prize here? Oh. Now, I don't know if that guy is a really bad soccer player or really good, because that's pretty much what I think half of this audience would be aiming for if given the opportunity. It's hard to be a busker, Rhett. You really got to grind.
You got it, yeah.
I'm sure he's claiming all that money he's making, too. Taxes and all that.
Oh, always.
Now, this picture of you, and I think this is Trev. It must have been last summer up in Saskatchewan. You guys are out at the lake.
A little hike. Yep. Yeah. Oh, jeez. I remember that one.
Yeah. Well, and I'm just... You got to fix that's a big walkway.
Stupid. Yeah.
I mean, you guys were wasted. That's part of the problem here. But I mean, we've been talking about it for years. You've got to fix that staircase back to the cabin.
Get to work on it, Uncle Stu.
Come on, Stu. If you just put down the bottle and pick up a hammer, none of this would happen.
God.
Your kids skateboard at all?
Oh, always.
Have you had any catastrophic injuries while skateboarding with the kids?
No, they do it on the carpet.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, keep them on the carpet and don't let them do this. Make them watch this.
Oh.
Yeah, that's not good. Sorry, Rhett. That's more graphic than I remember.
Holy shit.
Next. And if your kids still want to skateboard after that, then show them this. Because it just, the hits keep coming. Oh, jeez. No. That's the hardest bone to break in your body. I know it's cool and chicks dig it. That there's just a level of risk I'm not ready to inherit with skateboarding.
No, said actually dig it.
Okay, Jack. Yes. No. Yes, you that could is a do.
How many days do you think of 24/7, like, of skateboarders hurting themselves
on the internet?
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't measure in days. It's years.
Right? Like it's...
It would never end.
Because most of the time, it's a screw-up and an injury, not a success.
No, it's true. Like, X Games is the only televised skateboarding where they don't kill themselves. Everything else just fails, I swear. Yeah. It's crazy. Ugh.
Like, how much money
do you kill now, we've got Steve Irwin, who sadly passed, who we loved, the Crocodile Hunter, whatever we called him. We got the new guy that we showed you in Oz. I think his name's Mike. With the hot wife and the kids and all the huge crocodiles. And then we have people that are trying to make it as these sort of like wildlife experts. So let's see this genius.
What the wood will do is create a barrier between the turtle's beak and its ability to scissor all the way through my hand. Once the turtle bites me, I will show you how to get a snapping turtle off. And there are a couple of methods you can use. The first one is water bottles. Simply dumping water onto the turtle's face, in its mouth, and on its eyes should make it feel as if it's back into its natural environment, which would be the water, and it will let go and try to get away.
1 minute, 37 seconds later.
3. Ah! He missed the wood! And he's latched onto my hand!
You alright?
Give me a bottle of water. Place. Just lightly drip that onto the top of his head. He's biting that part. That's not working.
Okay. We got enough of these people. We don't need more. You're not qualified. You thought that little toothpick was going to stop the snapping turtle.
I feel like I want to see him try it on the other hand. I mean, he missed the stick. Maybe the stick does.
He needs to reevaluate and come back and use the other hand.
He again, needs to reevaluate.
The Snapping Turtle life. Didn't walk up to this guy sleeping in his bed in his house. He took the Snapping Turtle out of his environment and bothered him. I'm fine with all this.
Stupid people.
Yeah. I mean, you talked about the skateboarder, like how long that reel would go. It's stupid people highlights. It's, yeah, Walsh, you nailed it. Play a stupid game, get a stupid prize. People are stupid. Jason makes a good point. This is a very classic example of FAFO, which is fuck around and find out. We got some video trickling out of the last Greta party we had. This is this Mr. Public Pain? I think it is. So they got the punching machine here. That's the comment every day. And it's the punching machine. Thought he had the high score, but he just missed. Jeez. He was the guy that gave the big hug to Boomer that he still hasn't recovered from.
Is that the Viking bar?
That's Greta. What are you talking about?
One of the Sutter brothers.
No, don't. No strays for the Sutters today, please. Oh, Jesus. Couple left. Now, I've seen this before in Australia. I did not know it was a thing. And when I got there, I'm like, you got to be kidding me. So like in Alberta, we have the truck nuts, and everywhere else in the world you visit, you're like, really? People are choosing to do that. Like, that's a decision. You're going to put nuts. You're going to put testicles on your truck. In Australia.
There you
see have. You in the Northern Territory.
We should get one for Dean.
Well, I mean, that's Aussie Brad. So he could just probably order another and send us one. We'll see you in the Northern Territory. I keep telling you, very socially acceptable, apparently.
If you don't use it, you're a weirdo down there.
Like, that's not a handmade one-off.
No.
You can go get that at the store. I might get some keychains. I'm going for a wedding in September. I'm going to bring everyone a See You in the Northern Territory keychain or that's t-shirt. Cute. Deal?
Yes.
Okay.
There's a bunch of noise at this house.
Finally, we always like to close the Pinder Report with some exotic animals. I worry about this young monkey's future.
Found the mangoes.
Just dominating the mangoes.
Is that AI?
Oh, I watched that for the croc, mate. Look at this guy. He's a beast.
That thing is not intimidated by a croc. It'll sit on the croc.
Jabba the Hutt there, just rocking some mangoes.
I thought humans were only people that decided to sit around and get fat and eat too
gluttonous.
Much.
Gluttonous. Yes. He's clearly
love the
raised by humans. This is the problem when we interact with nature. That's it. That is your Pinder Report for Village Honda. Big shout out to Anthony and the gang up there. And a reminder, the Honda Civic continues to lead the way in value, reliability, and performance. The 2024 Civic, 10 out of 10 Car and Driver's Comprehensive Vehicle Testing. And the Civic Type R and SI, number 1 and 2 in the Sport Compact category, respectively. Head online to villagehonda.com or go say hello in the Northwest Auto Mall just off Country Hills and Stony Trail. What's up
for
the rest
of the week? How many hours are you? You're kind of like that Adam Schefter?
Screen time?
Yeah, screen time, looking up stupid.
So I will, Jack can speak to this because we have a special chat that is just Pinder Report content, and it'll be crickets for many, many hours of the day, and then it'll be bang, 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 bang. And Jack's like, what the hell's going on over there? So now with the better half, Dan Unda, it's typically the time that we would be sharing once the children are in bed. That's now crocodile time on my phone. Jack, can you confirm this?
I can confirm. I was out for wings the other night. It's 10 o'clock and I get like 10 notifications bing, in bing, a row bing, that Ryan bing. Is sending me Instagram reels. And my friend's like, what the fuck is wrong with this guy?
Why is your boss harassing you?
Why is
you?
He sending you crocodile videos at 10:30 on a Tuesday?
Can't you see I'm working? I'm working, babe.
Time well spent, Pinder. I love it.
I just, I'm fascinated by
stupidity.
Well, the crocodiles, really. I just can't get enough. Like, they're the more we watch these videos, they're just bleeping dinosaurs. Like, somehow they survived and everything else died. I don't know about the asteroid or smoke or whatever killed these things. They are still here. That is not an animal. That is a dinosaur. Like, when you look at that, that's not like other things on this planet. I don't know. Fascinated. Love it. Okay, what do we got next? Couple items to get to. Let us jump into our Betway bets of the day. I think we might have Jack dancing on some bets today.
Oh,
very good. Very good. Light slate in the NHL. We're going to have to get a little creative. Only two games. You know what you do? If the game's not a banger, oh boy, this game's going to suck. Well, hang on. What if I take the Blackhawks to lose by two or more? Now we're in business. Now the game is a little spicier. Betway, you can get a free bet up to $200 if your first bet loses. Now look, not going to win them all. If you lose and you get refunded, that's a win. That is right now exclusively using this QR code. Get in there, open an account. Your first bet, if you lose, you get all of it back. No minimum, up to $200 back. And then you can take win or lose that money. Have a little fun betting on your favorite sports. This offer only available outside of Ontario. And it is from our good pals at Betway. Okay. Two lopsided games. I'm focusing in on some props for players. Connor Bedard, 5 points a couple nights ago, Rhett.
Not bad.
He got bested last night with Braden Point getting six.
Oh.
Huh? Six? Calgary, boy.
Whew. Season for some of us.
Impressive stuff. I've got Bedard to keep warm. Hot would be the wrong word. Five is scorching hot, but two plus at home. Hawks fans are having fun. It's been a lost year, but they still get to watch Bedard. Bubble Bedard's been great. Over a point per game since he's come back from that jaw injury. Plus 250 for a two-point night for Bedard. And Frank Vetrano, his last three games, six shots, zero shots. I'm looking for a bounce back in Winnipeg from Frank the Tank. The pizza man will deliver. Minus 110 if he hits three shots or more. Jack.
Got some basketball for you guys today.
Oh, hoops. And in hoops.
Hoops. Denver traveling to San Antonio. Denver is 9-1 in their last 10. They are tied for first in the Western Conference. I think they cruise past Spurs. Denver minus 10.5. And if Denver's cruising, Jokic, 25.5 points. Hit the over on that. Last three games against the Spurs, 37, 39, and 26. Going up against the Slender Man.
Yes, Victor Wembanyama, the 7'4" Frenchman, he's been getting eaten alive by the big boy centers. I know Embiid went off for, 70 against him this year. I don't mind this at all. Jokic to just devour the rookie. Jack with some hoops. Love it. Some hardwoods, Red.
Yeah, I might have to watch Slender Man. Have you watched that show? It's very scary, Slender Man. Do you know what it is?
Do I need to hear more?
It's kind of a folklore, one of those.
Bit of a horror flick?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm going to pass on that.
Oh, okay.
I'm good.
So being tall doesn't mean you're good.
Wow, he will be really, really, really good, but he's basically, how many pounds of muscle does this 7'4" man need to add? Like 40, Jack? Like he is a beanpole.
How funny to, okay. This, how tall is he?
7'4".
So 7'4", and if he puts on 40 pounds, you wouldn't even notice it.
That's just to look, not even proportionate, but just to be like, okay, you're now not a lanky teen.
Oh, boy.
Embiid is huge. Like, he's 7' something, I believe. And we showed the clip in the fall, and Embiid's in warm-ups. He's like, get a load of this guy. He's looking up, and you're like, holy. And the guy's got hands. He can shoot. He's an athlete at 7'4". He's not just Sean Bradley. It's impressive stuff, Jack. Not tonight, though.
Is he really 166?
No, he can't be.
Impossible.
I mean, please tell me that's true. That's incredible if it is. I just don't believe it. That, again, the comment section can be in a bit of an adventure here. This is got to cite your references in a lot of works and studies. Comment section is not that. You can just make anything up. Yeah, he weighs 9 pounds. Sounds a little off. I don't know. So Jack's going to research
information.
That. What are you betting? I'm saying he's 210. Oh, 7'4".
I think he's more than that. 210? He's more than that. 7'4 is massive.
210 on the dot.
Oh! Even a broken clock.
Oh, yeah.
Betway, take advantage of this limited time offer. If you're saying, man, like I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it, and keep putting it off, here's your chance. Throw some dough in a brand new Betway account, and if your first bet loses, you get it all back anyway. Scan the QR code, bet the responsible way with Betway, and again, this offer only for those outside of Ontario. DoorDash, Brett, you are a veteran. It is a Friday. I want you to think about the hunger pangs you'll be feeling later tonight. It's a tournament weekend. We'll get to that. If you're not familiar with DoorDash, good to see you out of your coma. Love that you've recovered. Here's what you need to know. Food delivered to your house, and not just food, maybe groceries, maybe flowers, maybe it's a pharmacy. You can even do multiple stops. Why go leave your house? Have it come to you with DoorDash. Download the app, and for first-time users, download, enter the promo code NATION25, and you'll receive 25% off your first order of over $15 and free delivery. Love it. Here's what's on the menu tonight. Going to the hardwoods. I believe it's going to be Muggsy Bogues against Shaquille O'Neal. It's the Magic in Toronto to face the Raptors. Love it.
Go get them, Muggs.
Also, if you like those club tosses we showed you, Players Championship round 2 underway today from Florida. This is the 5th unofficial major. Great tournament. Great first really good field of the year for golf as well in terms of all the world's best, or arguably many of the world's best. And finally, Kings and Hawks. No Kane, but still Kopitar and Doughty. Sure. 6:30 puck drop there. Rhett, what's on your menu on a Friday?
I think I'm going out tonight, so I'm going to DoorDash something in for the kids. My middle guy is a sushi fanatic. I'm going sushi.
What's the order? Does he like the sashimi? Is it the rolls?
He likes the rolls.
Deep fried stuff?
With like rolls. 17 rolls. Like he will house it, just attacks it.
That could get expensive.
Oh, it's, yeah, very.
I mean, because these are small humans or large humans? Remind us.
They're growing humans. They're expanding. they're 7'4". Not quite so... They don't need the 40 pounds, I'll tell you that.
What, the oldest is taller than you, bigger feet, already grown out of some of your clothes, I imagine. That's where we're at 14, right?
Oh, yeah, he's passed me years ago.
Where is he in weight, though? Because that's where he's going to, not saying anything about your weight, but this is where you're lanky and he's for the next 3, 4, or 5 years, you're going to try to fill out that frame, right?
Yeah, 180, 6'3", 180.
Whew, 14. Yeah, there's a lot of, what's the name of that dairy farm that you go to?
Hoover's.
You're putting a Hoover kid through college, aren't you?
My assistant coach is actually named Hoover too. Weird. I wonder if he owns that.
You should be looking for a discount on milk, is my point. DoorDash, nation code, promo code NATION25 for 25% off your first order on the app, and enjoy free delivery as well. There you go. Bam. What's the tournament schedule? Where are we at for games?
Well, as soon as we tap out of this, we got a 3:15 Buffalo time coming up. And then we got the Catwalk Charity, and then tomorrow at 10:15.
And when do you run into this prep school from Rochester that feels like the real threat in States here?
Well, we wouldn't see them till Sunday if they make it. They lost this morning in a
shootout. Really? So does that, is the bracket been busted, so to speak? Or
now
they got to run the table or what?
You can throw one, but if you lose again, you're screwed.
You guys are 1-0 with this afternoon and then tomorrow morning. Okay.
We're beat up, though. Boys were short bench. We lost another top six winger this morning. We had top three defensemen out with Panomia.
Panomia?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Are you in a Brennan Evans situation, or are you okay with depth on the blue?
No, we're not. I'm going to battle through here. I'm going to battle through. I'll pull all the right strings. You know that.
Yeah. I'm not too worried
about it. I'm a motivator.
It is time to head into the Great Clips inbox. Every week, we invite you to join the show. Send your questions or comments to the Great Clips inbox with the email address. GreatClipsInbox@FlamesNation.ca. Also, if you are in the comments, Retro, just use the hashtag GreatClipsInbox, and we'll read your comments live on the air. As for Great Clips, what do you know? Well, how about this? 4,400-plus hair salons throughout the U.S. and Canada. It's the world's largest hair salon brand and the official hair salon of the NHL. Your time is valuable, Rhett. You don't be waiting around sitting in a queue. So what you do is use the Great Clips check-in app, see the wait time, check in on your phone, and get the haircut you want when you want. And you can opt in to receive the Ready Next text alert. Check a box. You'll be notified when their estimated wait time reaches 15 minutes. Zip, right over there, in the door, into the chair, away you go. For more information, check out the Great Clips website, greatclips.com. Great Clips. It's going to be great. So Boomer receives them. He forwards them to me. I will read them. We will react. Jack, you're going to watch the comments here. And how's the vibes been on this? I don't want it to feel like it's Ask Rhett all over again. And I do feel like we've seen a lot of callbacks from the show, comments more than...
Don't overthink it.
Hey, what's your favorite side of Thanksgiving? We've done that enough, right? So, Jack, if you have any in the inbox from the comments, start, and I'll start yanking these things from the email account as we rock and roll. Let's
see. Dean, Dean, Dean. J-Mac, there's no chance the Flames make the playoffs. There's too many teams. It's too many points.
So I get now any chance, would you give them a 1% chance?
Sure.
I'm kind of with you.
My kid asked me that while we watched the third period this morning, and Dad, what if they win every game? Would they make the playoffs? And I'm like, okay. I'll give you that. That's a lot of winning.
Running the table's not gonna be easy per se, given the
feel free to do it.
A second pair defense. But by all means. Be that 1 out of 100 Cinderella story. It sure would be entertaining and good for the show. Love it. What else do we have from the Great Clips inbox? Jack, you keep queuing them up. And this is from Chad. Hey, guys, how much pull do you have with Wendy's? They had the Kraken over 18 and a half hits last night. Okay. He's moaning about the look. I mean, yeah, I feel like we're not running the daily face-off survivor pool. Sorry about that. This one emailed in to greatclipsinbox@flamesnation.ca. This is from Rob. My greatest fear this spring is that the draft lottery kings up Highway 2 will somehow figure out a way to win a cup. Who should Flames fans cheer for to ensure that doesn't happen? So if we don't want the Oilers to win the cup, what do we want to happen? And remember, they got three teams in the West with conditional picks tied to them, too.
I think Dallas or Colorado are going to be extremely difficult to beat. And I don't like Winnipeg, but I know what it's like to be from a place like Winnipeg, Buffalo, Saskatoon. So if the Winnipeg Jets want to go on a run and have some success, I can get behind that.
I entirely agree with you. Winnipeg is maybe the least sexy market in all the NHL. And yet, if they went on a heater, I think everyone would jump on the wagon.
100%. Let's go.
It's not like they're the big bad. These guys have been screwing the rest of the league. Like, no, you cheer for the Jets. Hell yeah.
Yes.
Plus for Flames fans, you got Toffoli there. You got Monahan there. Some good storylines. Friend of the show, Brendan Dillon.
Adam Lowry.
Oh, Calgary boy. Hey, lousy player, Adam Lowry. Best Twitter handle in the league. Here's you want your dream scenario for Flames? Vegas gets into the three hole. They beat Edmonton in round one. That converts the third rounder from Vegas to the second rounder for the Flames. Vancouver then beats Vegas, and they go to the conference final. Dallas comes out of the Central. Dallas beats Vancouver and goes to the final. Vancouver's conditional pick triggers 4-3, and the Dallas conditional third triggers as well with them going to the cup final. Hit on all your conditional picks. That's all you got to do.
Just easy.
Just simple.
It's easy.
Connie, you writing this down? Call the league, get Mr. Edwards to put in a good word with Bettman. These things are all fixed, right?
Not a difficult thing. It's like
easy. Daily fix. Hi, hockey pundits. This is from G. Check out this McKinnon deke on Slavin. It's an old video from last year. Why did Slavin? Yeah, okay. I'm not breaking this down here. No.
Absolutely. It's not. Do you want to host the show by Great Clips? Come on.
No, it's definitely not that. This one is called Eggs. Hey, fellas, interesting question came up during my book club last weekend.
Love book club.
No, here's the thing. If there's any crime committed, Jack has an alibi. He doesn't read. He's not in a book club. Nonetheless, we'll move on. Do you think over the course of one day, you could eat your age in eggs. For example, if you're 40, do you think you could eat 40 eggs in a day? No limit on how they're cooked or not. They could be baked into other things, etc. And bonus for you, Pinder, do you think this should be more or less painful than the 42 nuggets? That is from Carissa. Rhett, you would be around 45 eggs, I'm guessing.
I can eat 7 or 8 scrambled eggs at once.
And if you did 7 or 8 five times, that would get you to 40. Oh,
I think you would. I think if you did that sort of thing, you'd really develop an allergy to the egg. I think there's a lot going on in the egg, and I think you can overdo it.
Let's think if you set an alarm and woke up at 2 a.m. and you just said, you know what? This is egg day. Whatever day we dedicate to eggs, this is the day. And you cook yourself a massive 8-egg omelet. You're done that by 3 a.m. You know what, Rhett? You're going to need to lie down for a bit. We'll wake you back up at 5. We do it again. Do it again at brunch time. Do it again in the afternoon. That would get you to 4 times 8, 32. Could you house another 13 between the afternoon and midnight?
I would need 2 more sets of that. Yeah. That's a lot of eggs.
Now, Jack, I have faith in you.
Now, am I doing it because I lost a bet and I also
what's your motivation here?
Yeah.
For $1 million? Is it so we can get a chuckle? What are we doing here?
Yeah, because I could do anything. But why am I doing it? Needs to be.
Jack, you'd be what, 25 eggs, something like that?
Yeah, probably. What was exactly the question? I was reading the chat.
Do you think over the course of one day you could eat your age in eggs? I would be 42 eggs. I think the only way you'd have to just start going straight up, just like that Korean gal in the video.
Have you ever done the actually put her egg in your mouth raw? And
apparently it's quite gross. I've done it in like Clamato.
The whole shell, the whole thing.
The shell?
Yes.
No.
That was our drunk contest at the lake when I was a dummy.
You got to eat the shell?
Yes.
Oh, that's awful.
Eat an egg.
The whole egg.
The whole egg.
No, thank you. I think if you're under 30, this is doable, Jack. If you're over 30, this is going to be an absolute.
Can I cook the eggs however I want them?
Yeah, that's what they said. Any way you want to cook them, eat them raw, whatever you want. You could make cookies with a dozen eggs, whatever.
Yeah, easy.
Easy, no sweat. Yeah, the age factor is really the killer here. That's from Carissa. Thanks for listening, Carissa. Appreciate that.
I don't think you should do it. Don't do it.
This email is called Fellas. I know Hanzik has had some injury issues, but since he's been back, he hasn't really taken a step forward from last year. Should we be concerned? So Samuel Hanzik, the Flames first rounder, they drafted in Nashville last summer. My level of concern would be mild to moderate. It's tough to develop and get better when you miss time to injury. And because you've been injured a few times in a row doesn't mean you're always going to be injured and you're cursed. It's probably just a circumstance of bad luck. Hanzik got sliced at last year's World Juniors. Then I think a shoulder issue this fall. Then he came back and I think he's been dinged up again. What you really want to see for Hanzik is a nice, healthy run where he can go out and dominate. But it sounds like when he's been good, he has dominated. You'd love to see well over a point per game coming out of your draft year in Major Junior. It hasn't been that. But I would give the young fellow time and read a cautionary tale / a upside story. Connor Zeri ran into a ton of injuries the 2 seasons immediately following his draft. He's been okay. Connor, are you concerned with Sam Hanzik? I don't see a lot of concern.
What the hell Sam Hanzik is doing, so I'm not concerned.
Yeah. Okay. Well, Jaden Lipinski is also on the Giants.
This much to worry about Hanzik.
Okay. We may see him next year. He's AHL eligible. So
do it.
When you're back in town, head coach of the Wranglers next year.
Listen here, son, I'm going to need you to play this way. No, I'm not worried about Hanzik. Worried about something else.
Good. Jack, any more in the live chat for the Great Clips inbox? Great Clips is going to be great. Question for Rhett. My wife going over boy names if we have another kid. She said she really liked the name Rhett. Did you get teased with the name Rhett growing up? How did you like having your name? How do you like having the name Rhett?
I would say I'm quite proud of my name. Original, and never once was I teased. ever.
Yeah. Well, and apparently Scott's wife loved it too. Like you
so
you
did might Boomer's have met her. Wife. There's a lot of wives out there that love me and my name.
There's a lot of Rhett's that are about teenage years now, and I'm starting to wind the clock back and 04, Red Mile.
It's a Welsh name.
Oh, Rhett's very, very popular in Calgary in this certain birth year. Odd. Got some Mikas and Jeromes and Rhett's, Robins. Fellas.
Oh, but if you're worried about getting picked on, absolutely not. Plus,
not an issue.
We do the picking.
Yeah, Rhett's are alphas. That's good to know that. That'll do it. That is our Great Clips inbox. If you want to contribute, Great Clips inbox at flamesnation.ca, unless you've got an absolute stunner that you're sitting on, Jack. I didn't give you the heads up. I'm sorry. Can people who do not eat onions be trusted? Well, do vampires eat onions? Is that garlic? It's garlic for sure.
I think it's garlic.
I enjoy a sauteed onion. Raw onions can be very difficult for many people.
We used to go fishing in northern Sask, and we would have cheese whiz and onion sandwiches.
Not with fish, just the
raw
on the side
onion, big fat slice of onion. Here you go. Delicious. Typically about 2 a.m.
That makes a little more sense. Yeah, when you're washing them down with your 30-second Great Western, that might help.
Right?
That is the Great Clips inbox. A reminder, get the Great Clips check-in app. You can see the wait time at each location. There's over 4,400 in North America. Gotta love that. Also, you can opt in for the Ready Next text, letting you know when you're 15 minutes away so you can arrive, get her done, get out of there, save your time. Great Clips. It's gonna be great. I think that's a very good version, edition of the inbox. It was not too hockey. It was not too Ask Ready. And aside from the dummy wanting you to break down a Jacob Slavin defensive play, we're not doing that. Pretty good.
We can do it again next week.
Yeah. And yeah, you know what? Great Clips. We'll have you back for one more week. Great Clips inbox at flamesnation.ca. Man, we're almost done the show.
We got to be done because I got to go.
Okay. Really, before you go, you were back in Calgary. You're back in Buffalo now. You had a Douglas mattress delivered to your door in Calgary. I've had it delivered here. Dino's had it here. We love our Douglas mattress. I get to spread it on the whole thing. I'm the king of the king at my house because Mama Bear's down in Australia. Best sleeps I've had on this mattress. Now, the old mattress was old. This is a problem. Why are we hanging on a 20-year-old mattress? This is an absolute disaster. Douglas mattress is amazing. Tell me, have you opened yours? Don't disappoint me.
It hasn't been opened. It's waiting for the shop. What am I going to do? I can't break it in by myself.
Gonna let this breathe for a moment. The Douglas mattress was named Canada's best mattress by Canadian Living, loved by more than 200,000 Canadians and over 10,000 five-star reviews. Avoid the pushy salesman, get it delivered to your door. And how about this? A 365-night industry-leading risk-free trial. For some reason you don't like it, you're gonna get a full refund, and you got a year to see if you like it. It took me, Boomer, our better halves, one night to know this was a keeper for sure. And if you order now, you will get a free comfort sleep bundle, two memory foam pillows, a pillow protector, a luxurious cotton sheet set, and a mattress protector, a $650 value, all for free when you order your Douglas mattress now. Go online, douglas.ca/flamesnation. That, again, douglas.ca/flamesnation. $650, that free bundle. Love it. Probably made right here in Calgary. That means high quality, and they're not shipping this thing over the ocean, through continents. It's right here. Quick delivery times as well. Big shout out to Douglas. Good Calgary biz. Love it, Red. Kick some ass this weekend, okay? Come back a champ. You're off the show if you don't win this tournament.
Ooh, okay.
Well, maybe your second will talk about it.
A lot of injuries, you know. It's teenagers. What am I going to do? All right, I got to go. Great to see you. Have a great weekend. I will be on Afterburner tomorrow.
Cammy and Rhett tomorrow after the Habs. It's an early start. See ya.